Hello and welcome to today's episode of Piano TV. I am Allysia, your host, and today we are going to talk about some of the hardest piano music that exists in all of the piano repertoire. We're going to focus on Franz Liszt. We've done videos like this in the past. We've done Rachmaninoff and Chopin, so this is the third in the set. You can check those out if you are interested. In today's video, we are going to look at eight of his pieces, which are widely considered to be hugely difficult. What we're not going to do is look at his concertos. I'm keeping this focus to solo piano only, and concertos are, like, they involve the orchestra and symphony. And they are really, really difficult, but they're not going to be a part of this list. Without further ado, let's get started. You're going to hear some musical examples. We'll talk about why they're difficult and learn some things about these pieces. So I already said let's get started, but let's get started now. Liszt has a set of three suites called the Years of Pilgrimage, and there are some of my favorite compositions that Liszt has written for solo piano. Each set is really distinct from the other, and they're full of really colorful and just emotive pieces. We're going to listen to a few so you get a sense of that. One of the most difficult pieces that Liszt wrote for the piano was from the second set, the Italian set, and it is dubbed the Dante Sonata. Liszt's second pilgrimage suite was composed between 1837 and 1849, of which the Dante Sonata is the final dramatic piece. It was inspired by Dante's Divine Comedy, based on the Inferno part of the poem, basically about descending into hell and then transforming. So it's epic, which is right up Liszt's alley, and it's a full 17 minutes-ish long. It's also a great piece to display and listen to Liszt's forward-leaning artistic techniques. This piece, as well as the other ones we're going to discuss on this list, is rated a level 9 in Henley's system, which is basically as hard as it gets. It's a licentiate performance level in the RCM, and then FRSM level 4 ABRSM. I know it's a lot of letters. But let's take a really quick listen to part of the beginning after the chordal introduction. The next one on the list is also a sonata. It's Liszt's B minor sonata, written in 1853. And this one he dedicated to Robert Schumann. Now, some of you may know that Robert Schumann had a sister who was also very skilled at the piano, and she hated this sonata and is quoted as saying, "It is only blind noise, not a single healthy thought, everything confused." And she wasn't alone. Brahms really hated it too, as did other composers. But another composer who also created what we might call blind noise, Wagner, really liked it, not surprisingly. Since the sonata is beastly difficult, it never really got popular until the 1900s, well after Liszt's death. Like the other piece, it's a Henley level 9 RCM level LRCM, so licentiate, and ABRSM FRSM level. That's going to be true for pretty much all of these, so you can just take what I just said and apply it to the rest so I don't have to keep saying it. This is a long sonata as well. It's 30 minutes. We're going to take a little bit of a listen to the beginning. We skipped a bit of the intro just to get into it a little bit more, and we'll listen through about 30 seconds so you can get a feel for how wild this one is. Liszt's Rigoletto concert paraphrase was composed in the mid-1850s, and it's based on Verdi's famous opera Rigoletto. Specifically, the third act, number 18, is where the melody's from. The story going on at this part of the opera was about betrayed love coming to light, which was poignant to Liszt at the time. He was having trouble getting legally married, so he was having a little bit of
little bit of romantic distress.
This isn't a sad-sounding piece, though. I don't want to give the wrong impression. If you didn't know the backstory and you just listened to it, you'd think that Liszt was writing it while being in a really good mood. It's a gorgeous piece that I find really shimmers, and it's got a really beautiful and clear melody line, which is because it's been taken from opera, so the melody is obviously going to come out prominently. It's also shorter than the other two. It's a 6-minute piece, so much more manageable to listen to. Not more manageable to play necessarily, though. It is still incredibly difficult. Let's take a listen. Liszt wrote many etudes, but none are as difficult as his set called the Transcendental Etudes S139. Of the 12 etudes in this set, 5 of them are considered to be among the hardest piano music ever. They were published in 1852 after undergoing a series of revisions for several decades before Liszt finally decided to publish them. And he dedicated them to Carl Czerny, himself a master of the etude. What I really like about this set of etudes is that they're very listenable. They don't just sound like exercises. Each one has like a colorful title and is just really colorful. Did I already use the word colorful? They're colorful! The 4th etude is titled Mazeppa, after a Victor Hugo poem of the same name. It's basically about a guy named Mazeppa who is strapped to a horse and then the horse is set free to run wildly. As you might imagine, Liszt's portrayal of this story is going to be very fast and intense and epic. And the things that make this one so difficult, we're not going to listen to it. We're going to listen to 2 of the etudes because those are the ones that I had access to recordings of, but I encourage you to listen to the whole set as always. But there's huge leaps across the piano. It's basic Liszt stuff. Giant leaps across the piano, really rapid fire playing. In this one in particular, there's some really fast thirds and just there's a huge amount of endurance to get this one done. The 5th etude in the set, Will of the Wisp, it's got this really nice light and fluffy feel, and that's what makes it extremely difficult to play because it's really, really fast and there's lots of technical acrobatics happening, but it has to sound light. Not only is it fast, there are lots of rapid double note sequences in the right hand, but the left hand, in typical Liszt-ian fashion, is doing lots of leaping. And then the notes themselves and the different sections are completely unpredictable, so it's not like you can just settle into a pattern with this one.
Number 8, The Wild Hunt, has the tempo marking presto furioso, or rather, fast and furious. In typical Liszt-ian fashion, there are huge 2 and 3 octave jumps, lots of octaves, and bravura for days. Let's have a listen to the little bit of the introduction so you can hear the fast and furious quality of it. If you do end up listening to the whole thing, you'll notice that the formidable intro opens up to a much more playful theme. Like, it's not like the whole thing, it's just this like angsty intensity.
Liszt's 10th etude, titled Appassionata, is probably the most popular of the bunch, and it's all about creating a really expressive, dynamic melody that's often very complicated to play because of octaves and stuff. One awkward thing about playing this piece is how close together the two hands are a lot of the time, in addition to like a lot of really challenging passage work in the left hand as well. This etude is written in sonata form, and a revised 1838 version of the coda was heavily based off of the coda from Beethoven's Appassionata Sonata, hence the nickname Appassionata. Let's take a quick listen to this one. Last but not least is Liszt's 12th etude in the set Chasse-Neige, or The Impetuous Wind Which Raises Whirls of Snow, is kind of like the translation. In addition to the near constant tremolos, which is the whole study part of this study, you've got all the standard Liszt stuff. You've got huge leaps, fast chromatic scales, big contrasts, but what I think is the most difficult of this, I've never attempted it, this is way out of my range, but to be able to capture the whirling snow effect, you need to be able to play with a certain amount of delicacy, which again is really, really tough when you're doing such rapid fire work.
Italian musician and contemporary of Liszt, Ferruccio Busoni said that the etude was the noblest example, perhaps, among all music of a poetizing nature. He described the work as a sublime and steady fall of snow, which gradually buries landscape and people.
And that is all for today's video. Hopefully that gives you some, maybe a deeper appreciation into some of the compositions that Liszt has written that are extremely difficult. Or maybe this has given you some ideas of pieces that are dream goals that you can play once you're, you know, super advanced at the piano. I know that whenever I do these videos and listen to these, it always kind of makes me salivate about, you know, 30 years from now when I can finally achieve that piece. I don't know how long it'll take me to learn some of these. Probably a really long time. But anyway, thank you so much for watching. You can give this video a thumbs up if you enjoyed it. Subscribe if you haven't already. And you can come hang out with me over on social. My Instagram account, I just want to mention it too. I've been doing a lot of personal posting and food posting and stuff. So it's not a music account, but if you're curious about like my life outside of piano, you can always hop on Instagram and say hello over there. Anyway, I'll catch you in the next video. They were originally... Sorry, Michael's waiting. They were... He just started dancing like this. Okay, now be quiet because I'm going to keep filming. They were published in... Go away!